गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स. टुडे द टॉपिक फॉर डिस्कशन विल बी ऑन अडल्ट ऑर्थोडोंटिक्स. नाउ व्हाट इज अडल्ट ऑर्थोडोंटिक? बेसिकली अडल्ट ऑर्थोडोंटिक ट्रीटमेंट इज द वन दैट इज स्पेशली टारगेटिंग पोस्ट एडोलेसेंट पेशेंट. जनरली इट इंक्लूड्स टूथ मूवमेंट कैरिड आउट टू फैसिलिटेट अदर डेंटल प्रोसीजर्स नेसेसरी टू कंट्रोल डिसीज एंड ऑल्सो रेस्टोर फंक्शन. एंड Of late, it has been the fastest growing area in orthodontics in the recent years. You can categorize the adult patient into two groups. One is the young adult of the age group 26 to 35 years, and the other one is the older adult of 36 or older. Normally, young adults fall into the group who actually decide to get treatment at the early age before their school times and all, but they didn't receive the treatment because of many reasons. Economy would have been a reason. Next is older adults who are 36 or older, who have other dental problems, and they come to orthodontist or being referred to orthodontist by some other dentist to do some adjunctive orthodontic treatment to make control of the dental disease and also facilitating the restoration of missing tooth in a much easier and a more effective way. You can classify the adult patients into class A, who require minor orthodontics, class B, who require minor orthodontics and prosthetic restoration, class C, who require major orthodontics, and class D, who require major orthodontics and prosthetic restorations. And all these people come, the orthodontic phase will come under rehabilitative phase or active phase, and then they undergo a maintenance phase, and that can be done with the orthodontic retention or temporary splinting or a permanent splinting. What are the limitations of treatment in adults? It's not the same as you're going to treat a younger patient. The adult patients, they have a limitations, and these limitations can be categorized into intrinsic, which are biological, and extrinsic, which are biomechanical. So what happens, there is a marked intrinsic limitation is that the lack of growth in adults. For example, if you take a skeletal discrepancy, the same skeletal discrepancy can be corrected with a growth modification. You can give a face mask, you can give a headgear for a patient in a growing phase, but that cannot be done in an adult patient, and therefore can be corrected only by orthognathic surgery. And also, if you see, look at the orthodontic treatment, the biology of the tooth movement says it is a result of cellular reaction to a mechanical stimulus. The cellular response may vary with health and age of the individual. So you look at the periodontium of the adult. What happens, as explained by Reeton, he says there is a measurable delay in bone formation in the adult that is not observed in the children. So you apply a force, there is a resorption on one side, there is a deposition on other side. That's what your biology of tooth movement says, your pressure tension theory says. So as the tooth moves, Reeton found the osteoblast is not doing its function properly. Osteoclast is working properly, so resorption occurs, but the osteoblast is not functioning properly. And Norton, what he said, there is insufficient source of progenitor cells due to less vascularity with increasing age, which accounts for delayed response to the mechanical stimulus. That is, the blood flow is very less because your capillaries thickness reduces as the age increases, and because of that the progenitor cells which come into action is also being reduced. And Graeber also pointed out that older persons are more prone to the root resorption. When you look at the alveolar bone, the cortical bone becomes more and more denser, that is the cortical bone increases and the spongy bone reduces. In other terms, the spongy bones are the one where the blood flow is going to occur. So when cortical bone thickness increases and spongy bone reduces, automatically the blood flow is also going to reduce. That is one. Next thing is the bone density is going to increase. The bone is going to become more and more of cortical bone, means the root doesn't move faster. There is more resistance for the tooth, root of the tooth, to move into the socket, and this again is going to be a limitation. And when you look at the pathology, the apical displacement of marginal bone level is a local factor that influences the biological background for tooth movement in adults. What happens? The marginal bone loss occurs and there is going to be a gingival recession. The bone is going to recede and if I am going to apply the same amount of force to the same tooth but at a different marginal level of bone, there is going to be a lot of moment which is going to be generated. In other words, to keep simple, I have to apply force as minimal as possible, as little as possible to move a teeth. And next thing, when you going to treat an adult patient, they are more likely to have a missing teeth. And also teeth may be reduced in dimension due to attrition, as well as teeth with large restorations might be found when you are going to treat an adult patient. And earlier we said Graeber found out that there is a likely more root resorption. That may be because the apical foramen is narrow, causing more likely root resorption. What are the extrinsic limitations? So as the patient or any person grows older and older, they are more prone for many systemic diseases or any disorders. So we do have a contraindications in which the patients are not supposed to undergo orthodontic treatment. Any uncontrolled or advanced local or systemic disease, like for example, take diabetes. If it is uncontrolled, you're not supposed to treat the patient. And when there is excessive alveolar bone loss, again orthodontic treatment is not indicated. And severe skeletal discrepancy, you might as well go for orthognathic surgery rather than doing an orthodontic treatment. And when you have inability to prevent excessive hard or soft tissue destruction, and movement of teeth against occlusal opposition or into the occlusal trauma, again in those cases it is contraindicated. No improvement in periodontal health, function or aesthetics where it is not possible, like the patient doesn't follow the oral hygiene instruction properly, and after doing several periodontal treatment also the periodontal condition is not improving, then in those conditions it is better not to do the orthodontic treatment for the patient. So where all it is indicated? One, the periodontal aspect, if you look to improve the tooth periodontium relationship by relieving crowding or closing spaces if present. So when there is a crowding, the plaque accumulation is going to be more. So by relieving crowding, you are making it easier for the patient to brush and maintain the oral hygiene. Next is prosthodontic. Whenever a tooth is tipped, to operate a tipped molar and to regain a lost molar space. And next is to redistribute the forces to achieve abutment parallelism, intrusion of supraraptor teeth, to achieve proper crown root ratio. All these conditions are where it is indicated for a prosthodontic purpose. A temporomandibular joint problem to improve the occlusal coordination with masticatory muscles and temporomandibular joint. Aesthetics to satisfy the aesthetic desires. All these I'll explain you on the later stage with the proper clinical pictures. So what is the adult orthodontic treatment objective? The typical adult orthodontic treatment objective is, first thing is dentofacial aesthetics, next is stomatognathic function, stability, and then a static and dynamic class 1 occlusion. And more often it may not be a realistic or necessary for all the adult patients. It's not possible for you to achieve all three. When you look at the Jackson stride, it's not possible for you to achieve all the three when it comes to an adult patient. What we have to do is we have to see which can be done more easily or which can be done to benefit the patient more, and the compromise of others. If the aesthetic is can be done better, you can compromise little bit on function or stability, or in other some other cases the function will be given important, you have to compromise a bit on aesthetics and the stability. And then the treatment in which goals are not achieved is not necessarily compromised. It's not like we are not doing a perfect treatment, but what is the best possible for the patient, that has to be done with a bit of compromise. So according to Profit, adult orthodontic procedure can be conveniently classified into three categories. One is adjunctive treatment, next is a comprehensive treatment, and then a surgical orthodontic treatment. So first we'll look upon the comprehensive treatment. Comprehensive treatment is nothing but a complete fixed appliance. Okay, any patient who requires a complete fixed appliance comes to a comprehensive treatment, or some patients who are referred from some other specialty, a prosthodontist or endodontist, they might, or periodontist, they might be referred to us. And if those cases go more than 6 months for a completion, and then also it is considered as a comprehensive orthodontic treatment. And The boundary between adjunctive and comprehensive treatment is not very distinct. Okay, it's just a marginal difference between here and there. When you consider doing a treatment for an adult, the main important thing is you have to look upon the requisites of the appliance. And the first and foremost, when patients, adult patients come for treatment, what they look upon is aesthetics. It has to be good in function, but at the same time, it has to be the best when it comes to the aesthetics. Both the braces and wires, there are aesthetically acceptable, must be aesthetically acceptable, because they don't, many of them, they don't go for a metal braces. Next, it should be simple to increase the patient compliance, and they should exert a light force. Fixed is better because to increase the patient compliance, and also they should be long acting to reduce the number of appointments and shortest possible treatment time. Patient, we don't want the patient to come very often to us, so it should be a long acting, and then at the same time there should be a shortest possible treatment time. We should finish the treatment as quick as possible. So here below, you look at the picture, there are four appliances of choice. One is a ceramic braces, and next is the ceramic self-ligating braces, and then you have lingual braces, where the braces is placed on the lingual aspect and not on the buccal aspect. And of late, we have more and more adults being treated with the aligner therapy. It is a clear sheet of plastic which uses a CAD/CAM technology to treat the adult patients and for any patients as such. Adjunctive orthodontic treatment. Now, what is adjunctive orthodontic treatment? It's nothing but a tooth movement that is carried out to facilitate other dental procedure to control the disease, restore function, and or enhance the appearance. Here, the orthodontist is not the principal architect. The restorative dentist is usually the principal architect of the treatment plan, and the orthodontist or orthodontics, which is done, is to allow better restorative treatment. For all, the role of adjunctive orthodontics. Number one, repositioning of a drifted teeth. Number two, regain space for a prosthesis placement. Number three, establish favorable position of the teeth. Eliminate plaque retentive area. And then relieve periodontal, occlusal and TMJ. This is the first case. What has happened? What you notice here is the right lower molar, second molar is missing, and the upper molar has drifted down. So there is lack of space. If you want to give a fixed partial denture or an implant here, I don't have sufficient occlusal clearance. That is because the opposite tooth has come down. So to facilitate the restoration, what the prosthodontist expects is we have to push the upper teeth much inside into the alveolar socket. That is, we have to intrude the teeth into the alveolar socket. So what we have done over here is we had placed a mini screw, one on the buccal aspect and one on the lingual aspect. So we're just going to place the mini screws, and then we are going to apply force with the help of each end, and then this is what the result we have achieved. So on the picture D, you look how much intrusion has been achieved. Oh, there is a sufficient clearance for the prosthodontist for him to place a crown over the implant which is being placed inside. And next is a very common scenario. Whenever there is a missing first molar, the second molar is going to tip mesially and also drift into the extracted socket of the missing six. So in this case, if I have to give a FPD, what the prosthodontist prefers is they want the tooth to be upright so that when the occlusal load can be transferred axially along the 5 and also the 7. So here again, they had placed a mini screw distal to the 7, and then with the help of E-chain, they had tilted it back into its normal position. So now we have sufficient space for 6 pontic, and also the occlusal force on the 7 and 5 can be transmitted along the axial direction, and this can facilitate a prolonged retention or a good restoration of the FPD. Next one is, we have a fractured tooth here in the picture A. You have a fractured tooth, and we want sufficient crown to be exposed outside so that the crown which is being replaced over the broken tooth can have sufficient retention. So what we have done now is, we have just placed a braces and then a button on the buccal aspect. The help of that button, we have just pulled the tooth down, so we can see how much it has extruded from A to D. You can just compare and see how much it has extruded. So I mean, this much amount of tooth structure as seen in picture D is seen, it will be easy for us to prepare a crown over that, and also the crown will have better retention when it's been done by this method. To relieve periodontal problems, you can see there is a lot of spacing here, a traumatic occlusion which is seen on the region of 3-1 and 4-1 and also 1-1 and 2-1, and all this is going to cause a bit lot of problem, and also the longevity of the teeth is going to reduce. It is, the teeth is going to fall off if it's in this condition. So what we have done is, we have done a bit of intrusion of the anteriors and also extrusion of the posteriors, relieved the deep bite and also closed the spaces so that the tooth will have a better support. The tooth will take support from each other. And finally, for retention, we have to give a splint in the lower and also the upper so that they have a better retention and stability. Apart from this, we have many patients who come for the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea. That is a sort of snoring. Actually, there is a difference between snoring and obstructive sleep apnea. Snoring is just a small obstruction. But obstructive sleep apnea, what happens, the patient will become breathless for a moment of time, and then again they will start respirating. So these patients, what we give is, we have a adjustable oral appliances which is going to guide the mandible forward, and also when the mandible is being guided forward, the tongue is also pulled forward. By this, the airway is being opened. So obstructive sleep apnea can also be treated by orthodontic treatment. And finally, surgical orthodontics. When it comes to surgical orthodontics, the surgical orthodontics as a whole can be divided into minor surgical procedures and also major surgical procedures. So the minor surgical procedures, the very famous one is corticotomy or the periodontal accelerated osteogenic orthodontics. Okay, these can be a short note, a periodontally accelerated osteogenic orthodontics, corticotomy can be a short note, and also a surgically assisted rapid palatal expansion. All these things are done in a adult patient where growth is very little and also the bone becomes denser. So corticotomy, what they do is, when the cortical bone is very thick, they will make a minute perforation with a surgical burr. They'll just elevate the flap, make minute perforation in the surgical burr into the cortical bone in the region where the tooth has to be moved. By doing this, they do something called as a regional acceleratory phenomenon. All these things are explained when we had covered the chapter of minor surgical and major surgical procedures. I'll just brush through it. So what happens is that the cortical bone will become less dense and it'll be easy for the tooth to move through the bone easily. This is corticotomy or periodontal accelerated osteogenic orthodontics. When it comes to surgical assisted rapid palatal expansion, basically when the mid palatal suture is fused, after 25 years it's very difficult for us to separate the mid palatal suture and do a rapid palatal expansion. But alternative method is, we can do a complete corticotomy. And in this region, what happens is that you can split the palate along just lateral to the mid palatal suture, and also you can split the bone on the buccal aspect above the tooth, above the apical part of the tooth, and then you can give a rapid palatal expansion device. Again, this is being explained to you when the expansion appliance is being done. And next is a mini screw placement. Most of the adult orthodontics involves placement of mini screws, and this Mini screw itself is a separate chapter which I'll be covering later. It is implants and orthodontics. And another is cosmetic surgeries, like lips become thin. In those cases, what you can do is you can just give a Botox injection to increase the fullness of the lips. And most of the actress, may it be a Hollywood or Bollywood or even Gollywood, all these people, they undergo cosmetic surgery for the lip to increase the thickness of the lip. And then periodontal surgeries again fall into minor surgical procedures. In cases where recession is being observed, you may require the assistance of a periodontist to improve the periodontal condition. And finally, the major surgical procedures, you have the orthognathic surgeries that is being done as a major surgical procedure. And for example, when there is a deficiency of mandible, you can do a bilateral sagittal split osteotomy, and then you can advance the mandible. When the mandible is in excess, you can do a same BSSO, but you'll have to remove a chunk of the bone and then you have to set back the mandible. And in case of maxilla, if maxilla is hypoplastic or retrognathic, you can do an anterior maxillary osteotomy and then you can advance and the maxilla as such. Maxilla is excess, then what you can do, you can do the same AMO and then you can do a setback. So finally, what all you need for the diagnosis and treatment planning? The first basic thing is the diagnostic record. All you need is a complete set of diagnostic records and should be obtained, including cast. A study model is a must, where you can study how much recession is being observed, how much spacing is there, how much crowding is there, and bite, how much, what is the overjet, overbite, all these things can be calculated using a study model. Radiographs, again, you need a set of IOP, a full mouth IOP, OPGs, and cephalogram is optional as it is needed for the case. And then a good set of extraoral and intraoral photographs. After taking all these diagnostic set, what you are going to do is you are going to sit and discuss with the patient about the treatment plan. Okay, when you discuss about the treatment plan, you have to tell and explain the patient about the biologic consideration. You have to tell them, like, you have a recession here and that means this cannot be treated in a routine treatment time, and also it will take a longer treatment time when it comes to adults. And then again, if spacing is there, you can give a treatment alternatives to the patient, like you can go for a veneer if in case you want the treatment to be done faster. And then the potential compromises has to be explained. When it's spacing, you can again give a ceramic veneering can be given, or a composite veneering, or orthodontic treatment. And again, you have to explain the pros and cons of every treatment and also the probable consequences which can occur in case of orthodontic treatment or any other alternatives. And once the diagnosis and treatment planning is been done, okay, how you arrive at a treatment plan is you collect a data accurately. Your study models, your OPG, your lateral ceph, IOP, everything is going to give a accurate data of the patient. Also consider the patient general status, like how healthy he is, if he has any other problem, medical related problem. Analyze the database, develop the problem list based on the patient's chief complaint. If it's spacing, address to the spacing. If it is crowding, address to the crowding, or any other difficulty, address to that. And then you prepare a tentative treatment plan. You're going to prepare a treatment plan. And with the tentative treatment plan, you're going to discuss, interact with those who are involved, like a patient, patient's guardian, like son can be there, daughter can be there. You discuss with them, discuss the plans, and also explain the options and clarify the sequence. Like phase 1 will be doing this, phase 2 will be doing orthodontic treatment, and phase 3 will be doing a periodontal treatment, and finally you'll have to go for a retention for this long time, and then acquire the patient acceptance. Patient acceptance is very important when it comes to treating an adult patient. Why I am telling this is, for patient, the adult patient complaints is very important. At least when they are young or something like that, you can just, it is very easy to get their complaints. Adult patients, once they feel that the treatment is over, they will become very uncooperative. It is always easy to treat a child rather than adult because they at a particular point of time, they don't listen to us. So acquire the patient acceptance and finally create a final treatment plan. So this is all about the adult orthodontics, which is being done for the patient. So I'll just repeat with a short recap of what I told you before. First, you are going to say what is adult orthodontics. Then you are going to classify the adult orthodontics into young adult and adult. And then you'll have to explain about comprehensive treatment where it is possible. You have to explain about adjunctive treatment where it is possible. And you have to write about limitations of the adult orthodontic treatment which is being done. And finally, you just draw the chart how you are going to arrive at the treatment plan. So I hope I had been clear with my class. I made this class very short because main thing is it doesn't come as an essay for you all. It may come as a short note. Like they can ask you about the limitations of adult orthodontics separately. They may ask you about adjunctive orthodontics separately. All these can be asked as a short note. Thank you all. Thank you so much.